Coming up on Green Bay Nation, the losing streak is over as the Packers dominate the Rams at home. But can this team carry the momentum to Pittsburgh? All that and more next on Green Bay Nation. Hello and welcome to Green Bay Nation. I'm Lauren Helmbrecht, and joining me to chat everything Packers, he's a Packers beat writer for the Green Bay Press Gazette, Ryan Wood, and he's a radio host for 107.5 and 1400 The Fan, Marcus Eversall. All right, we will address the elephant in the room that we were 0-3 last week in green and bold, probably because we thought Matt Stafford was playing.
Yes, exactly. That's a big challenge. I don't know about you guys, but making predictions on Wednesday when you don't know who's playing. I would like to set the record straight on our pregame show before the game when we found out Stafford wasn't playing. I did pick the Packers.
And my pick in the Green Bay Press Gazette was also, actually, I picked two. I picked one if Matthew Stafford played and one if Brett Rypien played. I like to hedge my bets. But, Lauren, you were texting us all throughout the game about all the things that we were missing. So it was a lot.
It was an interesting game. And let's start with the Matthew Stafford-less Rams. The Packers win 20-3. The defense holds them to one of the fewest point totals in 2 years. And Aaron Jones played really well, 20 touches. What is your biggest takeaway, in the positive sense, for the Packers from this game?
That, what you just said about Aaron Jones getting the ball. I mean, it all goes hand in hand. I just felt like the Packers made Jordan Love's life easier than they have maybe all season. And you look at the end result, you look at his numbers, Jordan Love goes 20 for 26. Now, Aaron Jones didn't have a great game necessarily statistically, but when you get Aaron Jones involved as early and often as they did, then you see what you see late in the game. There's a cumulative effect. The prettiest play in the game and that we've seen in a long time, the touchdown to Luke Musgrave, where Love fakes to Jones, he fakes to Dylan, and then Musgrave leaks out over the middle of the field. That's a play that you set up. I thought the play calling was on point, and I just thought they made it easier on their young quarterback, which should be a goal every week.
Supplemental to that, you know what also makes life easy on a young quarterback? Is playing clean and not having penalties every other snap. They had 7 in the first half, and some of these were just egregious. Now, I understand the John Runyon offsides calls. I mean, that's weird, right? That you don't see that every week, and they'll make an adjustment. But you're at the end of the half on the fringe of field goal range, and you're coming off a dead ball situation. You have a false start. Like, these type of things can happen. But Jordan Love had one incompletion in the second half, and they had about 2 penalties, I think. They played much cleaner in the second half. And when you do that, you're on schedule down in distance. You make life so much easier for the quarterback. They got to keep playing clean.
Now, on the other end of the ball, the Packers secondary could have used a lot of excuses in this game. No Rasul Douglas, Rudy Ford's injured, Darnell Savage on the IR. Instead, this young guy's really stepped up. Carrington Valentine said, hey, not too bad for a 7th rounder. Could we expect Valentine and Anthony Johnson Jr. to play like this going forward, or was it just a one-off good game?
That's a great question, and I don't think we know the answer to it yet. And to keep it all in perspective, we do have to consider that the Rams, that version of the Rams, just not very good. I mean, Brett Rypien's already been waived since that game. It wasn't pretty for them offensively. But yet, when you have 2 7th-round rookies starting in the secondary, there are a lot of backup quarterbacks in the league that can expose a secondary as young as the Packers were in that game. Carrington Valentine, the 232nd overall pick in the draft. Anthony Johnson Jr., 10 picks later, the 242nd pick. With Valentine, I feel like there's more of a sample size. Ever since rookie minicamp, you can't help but notice number 37. He just keeps passing every single test thrown his way.
If you're the Rams and you have to start Brett Rypien, that's the option you have. You look across the field, and from their perspective, you might be thinking before kickoff, well, at least the Packers secondary has a pair of 7th-round rookies that he can throw against. And on paper, that should have helped, but on the field, it absolutely didn't. This young Packers secondary completely shut them down, and that says a lot. I mean, it's a stepping stone for them to build on. They've got an interesting decision to make this week. If Rudy Ford, who was back at practice, turned from the calf today, if he plays, do they start Jonathan Owens, or do they start Anthony Johnson Jr., aside from Rudy Ford, developmental or more sure veteran? That'll be a very interesting decision for Matt LaFleur and his coaching staff to make.
So as much as we can say a win is a win, again, Brett Rypien, Matthew Stafford-less Rams. There were a couple issues. You already brought up the penalties in the first half. Christian Watson is still not really connected with Jordan Love just in general. What issue needs to be top of list for the Packers to address going into Week 10?
I think the deep ball still remains a concern. Now, we did see some progress. Even though passes 10-plus yards down the field, that's not exactly a deep ball, but Love was completing 36% of his passes 10-plus yards down the field coming into the game, and he was 75% in the game against the Rams, so that's some progress. But again, I keep bringing it back to the level of competition. That was basically the Rams' B team. They didn't have their number one running back, Kyren Williams. They were shorthanded along the offensive line. They were missing a couple starters on defense. So although the Packers are, they have no reason to apologize for any win, it's hard to really react accordingly or know how to react definitively until they do it against somebody else.
Yeah, as this season progresses, the number one question is, of course, is Jordan Love the guy? And I'm going to be slow to react to that because there's something worse than him not being the guy. The worst thing that could happen is for Jordan Love to be the guy, but the Packers move on before they realize that. They have to be darn sure. But the one thing, the one piece of evidence that we have seen to indicate that he might not have a long career in this league is he can't hit a deep ball. And if he wants to carve out a career in this league, he's got to hit. When Christian Watson runs two, three steps behind the corner down the left sideline, that's a layup in this league. He has to hit those throws or his career won't be long. So that has to improve.
Let's put a pin in that. We will be talking about the deep ball a bit later on the show. When we come back on Green Bay Nation, the Packers are out of their losing streak, but can this team turn that into a win streak? Green Bay heads to Pittsburgh for a chance to beat the Steelers in the Steel City for the first time in decades. Welcome back to Green Bay Nation. Lauren Helbrecht alongside Ryan Wood and Marcus Eversole. The Packers are back on the road. This time they're heading to Pittsburgh to take on Mike Tomlin's hard-nosed Steelers. Green Bay hasn't won at Pittsburgh since 1970. That's older than all of us, right? Maybe combined?
It's been a minute, slightly.
All right, well, if the team wants to end this streak, I think it will depend on the Packers' run game / getting the ball to Aaron Jones. I think you, Ryan, would probably agree with me. So how does Packers' run offense match up against the Steelers' run defense?
Well, we just saw it, right? We just saw what this offense can do, as Marcus said, making life easier for Jordan Love. If they just give Aaron Jones the ball. And it's not like Aaron Jones had a big game, not by his standards, but it makes everything just look so much smoother, so much easier. And in this matchup, the best way to negate a great pass rush, which is what the Steelers have, is you run it right at them. You don't let them just pin their ears back, dig their toes in the ground, and get after Jordan Love. You give them the run to think about. So this is a week that, yes, they need to, I know it's 2 weeks in a row, they need to give the ball to Aaron Jones. It makes everything, the whole process just look so much better.
And even A.J. Dillon in that photo there plays better, per his own admittance, when Aaron Jones is playing well, because it is supposed to be that 1-2 punch. All right, Marcus, so the Packers get a win. They're out of the losing streak. But what do you need to see from Matt LaFleur to prove that it wasn't just a one-off against a bad Rams team and that he's actually made adjustments?
Well, I don't want to take everything Ryan just said and run it back, pun intended, but I think that's a big part of it. Listen, we have heard time and time again how they need to get Aaron Jones the ball more, and that's what they want to do, and then sometimes we just don't see it. We just saw what happened when they fed Aaron Jones early and often. He had 10 touches on the first two possessions. Now, to Ryan's point, the numbers don't look great. He only gained 38 yards on those 10 touches on the first couple possessions. He touched it 24 times for the entire game, 99 total yards, so the numbers aren't great. But for a young team, you keep hearing that they want to find a rhythm, and that's been so elusive this year. A good way to get into a rhythm is to start the game fast, to get into get more bites at the apple, more swings at the plate, whatever analogy you want to use. Aaron Jones is a chain mover, and it takes its toll throughout the game. I think you got to start there because they do have to do it against somebody not the Rams B team like they did on Sunday.
Yeah, Lauren, if you can't tell, we think that they should give the ball to Aaron Jones. I asked Matt LaFleur this today, any hesitancy, and he said not so much hesitancy, but A.J. Dillon's playing his best ball of the season right now. So stay tuned.
I just think it becomes the 1-2 when Jones is playing well, because when Jones was out injured, it wasn't like A.J. Dillon took the whole load on. They need to complement one another. All right, so doesn't seem like there's drama in the running back room, AJ and Aaron, like working together. But in Pittsburgh, there is a little drama. So if you didn't know, on Thursday night, the Steelers beat the Titans. But George Pickens, He only had 2 receptions for negative 1 yards. He had a go-ahead touchdown, couldn't get 2 feet down. Then his fellow wide receiver, Deontay Johnson, scores the game winner. Then Pickens goes on Instagram, says, free me. Look, there's some drama going on in the Steelers wide receiver room. I think Jaire Alexander might enjoy that a little bit. Do you think it'll be a factor at all in this game?
Well, it's funny you bring up Jaire Alexander. He's aware of all that. If there's any effect on the game, it'll be just in the trash talk department, I think. Like, Jaire will let him hear about it. But I don't think it'll have any impact on the game. They're really good players, George Pickens and Deontay Johnson. They will have an impact on the game. I don't think the drama will from social media. But sometimes, we've seen this time and time again, the squeaky wheel gets the grease. Sometimes when receivers aren't happy, they tend to get the football a little more. I'm just saying.
It'll be interesting to hear what Jaire Alexander has to say Friday at his locker. Look, George Pickens had an 800-yard receiving season last year as a rookie. He's an up-and-comer. He's not Devontae Adams. He's not A.J. Brown. He hasn't established himself to that level yet. So it's a little different when he's saying, give me the ball. What does have a big effect beyond the high school stuff, what has a big effect on this game is that Kenny Pickett's not very good. And, yeah, Jaire Alexander could maximize on that. But Carrington Valentine getting another start has a chance now. Kenny Pickett's not Brett Rippon, but he's not very good. He's not Patrick Mahomes either. It's another opportunity for this young secondary, Carrington Valentine, to build on last week and to get some confidence and momentum going.
We saw Carrington in the game against the Rams. He might have picked up a little on the trash talking from Jaire. He was standing over Puka Nacua, counting fingers, everything.
He had swagger.
He definitely did. All right, when we come back, Mike Tomlin has led the Steelers to 16 straight seasons with a winning record. We're heading to the Packers' locker room to hear how Green Bay's players feel about the hard-nosed Pittsburgh Steelers. Welcome back to Green Bay Nation. The Packers have one of the best home field advantages in the NFL. In the past decade, Green Bay has won 73% of their games at Lambeau. But right behind them, Pittsburgh Steelers. No matter where these two teams play, it's going to be a tough game. It's time to go in the zone. Cam is there.
Ever since a dominant Week 1 win over the Chicago Bears in Chicago, the Packers haven't won on the road, 0-3 since that victory. And even though the team is traveling to Pittsburgh and it might sound like a raucous environment, these players are just treating it like another game.
I feel like it's the same energy, just not our fans there, but our fans do a good job of traveling to our game, so we'd be hearing the Go Pack Go on the sideline, so that'd be pretty sweet. But really, we try to keep the same focus, home games, away games, and just try to go out there and do our job.
I mean, no, I think there's a different energy to playing on the road, and I think you can still, you know, use that in a really positive way, and I think that that's our plan.
Me just being a football fan, you know the lineage that's been down, went down there. We know the type of brand they want to play, physical, defense, you know. So for us going into this game, we know it's going to be a smash-mouth type of game, and we got to bring our pads, so let's get it on.
I like away games because everybody loud, you know, the whole crowd loud, and then when you get to the third, fourth quarter, everybody's just quiet at that point because we won the game. So I like just going to people's stadium and basically just taking over.
Okay, so Elgton Jenkins likes to play on the road more. It hasn't seemed like it this season with losses to the Falcons, the Raiders, and the Broncos. But Pittsburgh, well, it's a different environment. And guys, how do you feel like this Packers team will do coming off a win, but knowing they're entering the house of TJ Watt and those terrible towels?
All right, now it's time for Q&A with Green Bay. I'm going to expand Cam's question again. Not just the Packers, but Packers fans playing against TJ Watt at the Steelers.
Yeah, a lot of people forget that the Packers actually had a chance to draft TJ Watt in 2017. They had the 29th pick. They passed on Watt, and then Watt went with the next pick to Pittsburgh, and the Packers took Kevin King. Not many people talk about that ever.
I just forgot reminded of that.
Yeah, you're welcome.
There's a reason why they did that. Maybe it wouldn't have hurt so bad if T.J. Watt was T.J. Jones, not J.J. Watt's brother, and if he was from Ohio State or any other Big Ten school but not Wisconsin. But it would still hurt. This is the bottom line of biggest need versus best player available in the draft. The Packers were coming off 2016 NFC Championship game where their secondary got exploded on, and they lost in a blowout. They thought they needed more speed in the secondary. Kevin King enters the picture. He's out of the league now. TJ Watt looks like JJ Watt.
So definitely a factor, TJ Watt. We'll see how he plays in the game too. All right, when we come back, it's time for Challenge or No Challenge, presented by the Good Guys Heating and Cooling. That's next on Green Bay Nation. time now for Challenge or No Challenge here on Green Bay Nation, presented by the Good Guys Heating and Cooling. If you agree with what I have to say, nothing happens. If you disagree, the flags hit the floor, just like Matt LaFleur. All right? Sounds good?
Sounds good.
All right. So Ryan is probably the biggest advocate of get Aaron Jones the ball. I think the Packers will get him the ball in this game. So challenge or no challenge, Aaron Jones gets at least 15 touches against the Steelers.
I will not challenge that. I will challenge Ryan being the biggest proponent of Aaron Jones getting the ball because I am right there in lockstep with him. But if Aaron Jones doesn't, there's a law. Years ago, I said there should be a law that Jones touches the ball at least 15 times every time he plays. That should still be in effect. If he doesn't touch it 15 times, something's wrong.
Yeah, that makes sense. We just had an entire segment on saying how that made sense, right? Just saw the offense look a lot better. Yeah, I'm challenged. I'm not letting you pull the rug out from under me. A.J. Dillon's playing the best football of his season right now. They're not going to do it two weeks in a row. Makes sense. They should.
Just because you want it doesn't mean it's going to happen,
yep,
right?
Yep.
Well, speaking of that, just because it's been an issue doesn't mean they haven't tried. Jordan Love is still throwing the deep ball, still trying to connect with Christian Watson. Hasn't gone really well. Maybe they turn a corner in this game. So challenge or no challenge, Jordan Love has two passes of at least 20 yards.
I will challenge that. I mean, maybe two completions of 20 yards, but if we're talking throwing it down the field, I'll believe it when I see it. I think they're going to come out more run heavy and hopefully Aaron Jones oriented, but I'm going to try to make that the last time I say the name Aaron Jones on this show today.
Well, Aaron Jones might not get 15 touches, but I don't think Jordan Love's. It might be more likely, and I hate to put this on him, it might be more likely to have two sacks of 20-yard losses than two connections of 20-yard passes. It's just, we haven't seen it.
All right, well, that'll do it for this edition of Challenge or No Challenge presented by the Good Guys Heating and Cooling. When we come back on Green Bay Nation, time to get green and bold going into Week 10. Welcome back to Green Bay Nation. It's time to wrap up the show and get green and bold. Marcus Ryan, who do you have winning in Week 10?
I'm going to take the Steelers. I just think this is every Steelers game seems like it's the same. It's close, it's kind of ugly, and the Steelers find a way to win in the fourth quarter. I expect another close game, and the Steelers are better in those games.
This is actually a huge game when you think about it. I said coming out of the bye that if they could, their next four games, go 2-2, there might be a chance. Well, they lost the Broncos, which was awful. They lost without Justin Jefferson, Kirk Cousins to the Vikings. And they kind of rescued themselves, got a little help from Brett Rippon. But if they can go 2-2, they can beat the Steelers. Yeah, I got the Steelers winning.
You keep doing that. You build it up.
Juke and just last
yeah,
second.
A little 1-2 step.
Just try. Yeah, I got to be real.
No. All right, I don't know if I'm just being a contrarian, but I actually have the Packers winning this game.
Good for you.
I think that the Packers saw that if they feed the ball to Aaron Jones, that the team as a whole works better. So if they just do that in this game and run the ball, then it spreads the field out. There's so many more options. So I don't know. We went 0-3 last week, so at least one, someone's going to be right this one.
Hedging our bets.
It is a winnable game. Like, the Steelers are not that good. It's winnable.
It's a winnable game.
All they do is
win.
All
right, that'll do it for this edition of Green Bay Nation. Thanks for tuning in.